I am truly pleased to be with you at the beginning of this important conference. I believe that this conference is creating a space for international academics, specialists, practitioners, and civil society activists to share your experiences, expertise, and good practice. It is my pleasure to welcome you to Malta, at the heart of the Euro-Mediterranean region, as one united community. Malta is a most appropriate place for such a conference, because we have not only adopted the Istanbul Convention, but also during Malta's presidency of the Council of the European Union in 2017, my government put the issue of violence against women high on the European Union agenda. This directly led to the European Union's accession to the Istanbul Convention during the Maltese presidency. Let me take this opportunity to urge all those member states who have not yet ratified this important convention to incorporate it into their national laws and practices. On the other hand, the University of Malta, through our own Dr. Marceline Naudi, her initiative, together with a number of experts from the region, has set up the very first European observatory on femicide, which will provide essential data about the most lethal forms of violence against women in Europe. However, even though we have so many legal instruments in place and so many other practical initiatives that are being taken up, unfortunately, the scourge of violence against women is still unacceptably prevalent in our societies. Before delving deeper into my opening remarks, I would like to thank Stephanie, Rosa, and obviously Marceline for their efforts to facilitate this very first conference in Malta on its 20th time, the WAVE conference. Please also permit me to acknowledge the presence of our Maltese organizations who work so hard in the sector to promote women's rights, gender equality, provide empowerment and refuge for many survivors and their families. I am confident that this event will further give further visibility across the Euro-Mediterranean region of the needs of women who are experiencing violence and injustice. Specialist services for women and their children have a powerful, empowering, and unique role to play to end violence against women within our communities and our societies. As you all know, research shows us that with the support of specialist services, women and their children are more able to overcome their experiences of violence. To truly and sustainably safeguard the rights of women, I believe that all of our efforts must focus on ending gender-based violence, while also focusing on promoting, empowering, and educating for gender equality in our societies. In this context, a rights-based approach must be adopted at all times to ensure that we will not only address the trauma of violence, but even more so to address the root causes of gender inequality. To ensure that universal human rights are safeguarded for all, our governments must work alongside civil society activists and organizations to provide effective and appropriate services. Guidelines from the UN Women Handbook for National Action Plans on Violence Against Women makes this very clear. UN Women declares that while the state should play an important role in establishing and funding services for women, however, the state is not always the most appropriate body to run these services. And I am quoting. UN Women also emphasizes the specialist crisis services set up to respond to victims and survivors should be run by independent and experienced women's non-governmental organizations. I would like to emphasize this statement by UN Women, as I am so convinced that the contributions of civil society activists and organizations are so essential at every level of implementation. I believe that only an enabled network of women's organizations can provide the best safeguards for women. Such a network should provide the necessary expertise and gender-specific support, which must be based on the principles of feminism and social justice. We know that sometimes the word feminism causes discomfort to some people in our societies. As I was preparing for this for these introductory remarks, I came across the inspiring words of Dr. Cherise Cramare, where she stated that, and I quote, "Feminism is the radical notion that women are human beings. Such a notion is indeed radical in thought. It touches, however, the core of gender-based violence, inequalities, and patriarchal oppressions, because we still live in a world that is overwhelmingly governed, legislated, policed, and predetermined by men. Unfortunately, women's perspectives are many a time excluded in our societies. Therefore, as we all know, gender equality is not being adequately safeguarded. Legislation is important. However, we cannot take our legislation for granted. It must be part of a larger process, which includes behavioral, social, and cultural change." And I would like to share a couple of experiences, very recent experiences. Yesterday, I spent all the whole morning with two situations of gender-based violence. Two families, a mother and children, and a child, and the mother and four children, who are terrorized by their former partners and spouses. And unfortunately, even though they have been reporting, and even their former spouse and partner have been taken to court many a time, they are still not only on the run, but also still terrorizing their lives. And I had to facilitate to give them some peace of mind, some peace of mind, yes. And this is why I'm speaking of civil society and women's organization, that they need to be enabled. Because through my experience in Malta, our civil society, our women organizations are doing wonderful, sterling work. However, they need to be enabled and supported by all authorities and all the people in the sector. A feminist culture within our societies, embedded in social justice and human rights, definitely will ensure that all forms of violence against women are understood in the proper context of unjust social dynamics and power imbalances. Gender-based violence is the effect of gender imbalances and injustices, and are as a result of patriarchal oppressions, where male dominance and privilege are not only normalized, but also enforced within our societies. The shocking data when it comes to the oppression of women and violence against women is not new to any one of us. However, such data is a stark indication of just how much further we need to endeavor to make the world a safer, more respectful, and more dignified place for women and girls. As we all know, violence against women and girls is one of the most prevalent and widespread violations of human rights in the world. It is mind-boggling that on the 70th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which will be observed this year, global estimates published by the World Health Organization are still reporting that one in three women have experienced either physical and/or sexual violence from an intimate partner or sexual violence from a man that they did not know in their lifetime. Another indicator is the estimated 38% of murdered women globally who are killed by a male intimate partner. Let me take this opportunity to say that we also need more comprehensive data about femicide in all of our countries. And that's why I commend what the initiative of Dr. Marceline Naudi to set up this femicide observatory in Malta. Other situations that we must take into consideration is the fact that we are still living in a world of conflict, post-conflict, and displacement. These situations, which are escalating in so many parts of the world, lead to increases in pre-existing violence and the emergence of new forms of violence against women, such as rape, as a weapon of war. Another striking example of patriarchal oppressions, which we have seen in a recent and highly publicized case internationally, is the testimony of a woman who survived an attempted rape and was denigrated, ignored, mocked, and downgraded. Unfortunately, we have seen so many a time the repercussions on our girls and young women who feel powerless or under threat due to negative media influences and the lack of critical awareness about the cultural and social inequalities that exist between women and men. And yes, we need the media, a gender-sensitive media, because this will help us in our endeavors to overcome the scourge of society. These are the reasons that make women's organizations even more essential in the fight to eliminate prejudice and violence against women. The United Nations Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women recognizes women's organizations, and I quote, as the single most important factor to drive policy development that prevents and responds to violence against women and their children, unquote. I would like to be very clear that even though I believe that the work of specialist women's organizations is crucial, they need to be enabled and supported by all the authorities working in the sector. We need holistic and truly effective service provision, which is built upon a gender-sensitive understanding of violence. This is also declared in the United Nations Declaration on the Elimination of Violence Against Women, which says that violence against women is, and I quote again, a cause and a consequence of gender inequality, and services should be delivered based on this understanding. Therefore, as you discuss and develop new strategies for the benefit of the survivors of gender-based violence, let me urge you to keep your thoughts focused on a women-centered, trauma-based, and empowering approach. Service providers in the sector of gender-based violence must do their utmost to equally highlight intersectional vulnerabilities arising from age, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender identity, or disability. And I believe this is very, very important. We must bring women affected by violence to the table, because women are the experts on their own healing. They must be empowered as valuable contributors in their recovery from violence and trauma. I also believe that we must not only recognize the voices of women as the experts in this area, but also the voices of their children. I would like to urge our governments to continue investing in specialist services for women and their families by working more closely with women's organizations and educating all those who, in some way or another, have an input in the services being provided. Definitely, in order to create a sustainable and far-reaching transformation within our societies, we must work together. We must work in synergy. The women organizations in our countries must collaborate and create stronger partnerships on a regional and international level. On concluding, I would like to remind you of the words of former US Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, who said, and I quote, "There is a special place in hell for women who don't help other women." And I think this convinces me even further that we need to work in synergy. We need to work together. There is a fight, but we can overcome if we can do it together. All of us women must be prepared to support one another in all the ways that we can. This is not a fight that we can win single-handedly. As international academics, specialists, practitioners, and civil society activists working to eradicate the scourge of gender-based violence, you are the best examples of solidarity, passion, and courage, which should define us as women in the 21st century. Thank you.